Edmund Gharib is an author and scholar on the Middle East. He joins us now to discuss the growing conflict. Edmund, thanks so much for being with us. We heard Netanyahu there. From the Israeli perspective, or at least trying to be inside the minds of the military right now, what do you see as being the short and long-term objectives, and how is this different than sort of past operations?
Well, clearly, this is different from what we have seen in 2008, 2012, 2014. There is a new level of escalation. We have seen, for the first time, Hamas able to launch rockets. Yes, Hamas does not have the equivalency or the equality in terms of military capabilities between them and Hamas. And the Israeli army is probably the most powerful army in the Middle East and one of the strongest in the world. So basically, there is no symmetry there. But here, the Hamas is doing two things. One, it's showing that it can defy the Israelis on the one hand, and also it's looking at the conflict, because there has been conflict between Hamas and the Palestinian Authority in Ramallah, and that's another factor, especially after the postponement of the elections and by the Palestinian leadership. So the Israelis are trying to send a message that they can inflict a great deal of pain on Gaza. Gaza, and for all intents and purposes, is an open prison. People don't have electricity 3 hours a day. They don't have clean water. They don't have the medicine. So Gaza is a very, very poor, very conflicted reality on the ground. And so, but both sides are, on the one hand, the Israelis are trying to show that they can inflict pain and damage on Hamas, on Gaza, so that no attacks, no further attacks will take place. Hamas is sending a message that the Palestinians, even though they are not equal to the Israelis, they can still defy Israel and inflict some pain on the Israelis. But what's new this time is that we saw these rockets reach the Ben-Gurion airport, other airports as far as 230 kilometers. We have also seen attacks on Tel Aviv, on some, and not only on the towns like Ascalon and Ashdod, which are near Gaza. So this is a new reality on the one hand, but ultimately the balance militarily has not changed in a dramatic way. And unless there is a solution, I think we're going to see a continuation of this cycle of violence.
I want to talk about some of the domestic Palestinian calculations there. You mentioned the elections, and one of the obstacles was that the PA was insisting that Palestinians in East Jerusalem be allowed to vote. One of the things that caught my attention early on in these Jerusalem protests was the presence of Hamas flags flying there outside of the Al-Aqsa compound. Hamas now trying to show perhaps that it has a grip in East Jerusalem, which may be important from a domestic consideration. Can you talk a little bit about that, and also some of what we're seeing between Palestinian citizens of Israel, or Arab Israelis, as they're often called, and within Israel proper?
This is really put your finger on one of the major issues in the current confrontation. How did this conflict evolve? It evolved primarily when the Israelis were trying to expel Palestinians who live in East Jerusalem and the Jarrah neighborhood. This led to protests by Palestinians in East Jerusalem, and these protests were met with very heavy-handed response from the Israeli authorities, including an attack on Al-Aqsa Mosque, which is, as you know, is a symbol, major symbol for Muslims, for Palestinians. And it happened in the month of Ramadan, which is the month of fasting, one of the holiest months of the Muslim world, the Muslim faith. So that this confrontation led, in a way, contributed to the unification of the Palestinians. It strengthened Hamas's point of view, because Hamas has been saying that negotiating with the Israelis is not likely to lead to a solution. Nobody cares about us. There's a lot of anger. There's a lot of frustration among the Palestinians. especially after what happened under President Trump, when he recognized Israel's capital to be Jerusalem, when he moved the embassy to the American embassy to Jerusalem, and when he also recognized the Israeli annexation of the Golan Heights. So basically, there is a lot of anger, there is a lot of frustration, and we see this response from the people on the ground. They can't do very much, but at the same time, yet they are willing to resist. And what's new, and that's the very important point that you just mentioned, the role of the Palestinians who live in Israel, the Israeli Arabs, who have so far have not been major players. Yes, there are some symbolic protests once in a while. There's criticism of the way the Israeli government treats them, but they have not participated. This time we saw in part of it, again, because the Israeli government has been trying to move some of the Arabs, change the demographic balance in some even of the cities inside Israel, such as in Lod or in Jaffa, and as well as in East Jerusalem. And that has brought more unity among the Palestinians than we have seen in a long time.
And surprisingly, Edmund Gharib, we'll have to leave it there, but surprisingly, the West Bank in all of this has been relatively quiet. We'll see what happens there in the coming days. Edmund Gharib, thank you so much for joining us.